Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Secrets of Next Level Entrepreneurs, 11 Powerful Lessons to Thrive in Business and Lead a Balanced Life, by Alex Brueckmann, narrated by Danny Campbell. Limit of Liability / Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including, but not limited to, special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. Why I compiled this book and who it is for. We have gotten used to hearing that we live in unprecedented times, that the speed of change and disruption has never been greater than now, and that our world is increasingly volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. As if we had required any more proof that these statements are true, the COVID-19 pandemic and the war in Ukraine reminded us that peace, prosperity, and health cannot be taken for granted. Effectively, we are witnessing supply chain disruptions and inflation rates higher than we've seen in recent decades, especially in the Western Hemisphere. We have been adjusting our consumption patterns with consequences for how much money we spend. We see new demands from an increasingly flexible workforce, challenging traditional career paths and prioritizing their personal over work lives. Digital innovation has maintained a high pace. While it enables new business models and entire industries on the positive end, it can also feel overwhelming to keep up to speed with digital transformation. Countless businesses, small and large, were swept away by the chain of events that sparked in 2020. Some of them had operated unsustainably for a while. For them, these crises were the nail in the coffin. Others operated under business models that were profitable but too inflexible. They got dragged under the bus because they couldn't adjust to a rapidly changing environment. All other businesses must learn the lessons and equip themselves for the next inevitable inflection point, and come it will. If we learned one takeaway over the past two decades, it is hopefully this: the next crisis is already waiting around the corner. I have spent almost my entire adult life in one crisis or another, from the dot-com bubble burst, the war on terrorism, the financial crisis, the state debt crisis, the refugee crisis, the COVID-19 pandemic, and Russia's war in Ukraine, to name the most prominent ones. Let's be honest, crisis mode seems to be the new normal, and most of these crises are outside our immediate circle of control. But it's not all doom and gloom. The changing landscape opens opportunities for business owners willing to create more appealing offerings for consumers, employees, and shareholders. Instead of hoping and waiting for better times, we must adjust our businesses strategically and operationally to make the most out of what we can immediately influence. As entrepreneurs, corporate leaders, and business owners, we must prepare ourselves and those who work with us for the future. It starts with us and how we grow beyond what we know today. What made us successful in the first place, the subject matter expertise we used to build our businesses, will not suffice to create the same caliber of success. We must learn essential skills, understand ourselves, and shift our mindsets accordingly. The time is now to reach the next level and grow beyond existing limits, personally and professionally. There are three mission-critical pillars that contribute to building future-proof businesses: strategy, leadership, and self-care. It's essential to strategically readjust a business for success, continuously shape leadership and culture, and practice self-care as we humbly accept our limitations as entrepreneurs and leaders. Instead of celebrating the hustle culture, promoting a glamorous view of entrepreneurship, or glorifying the few that amassed incredible wealth, this book is about what I call next-level entrepreneurship. It's about building businesses that take the right steps to do well, be profitable, and contribute to building more equitable communities. It is for entrepreneurs and leaders who embrace their responsibility for social and environmental justice and are eager to contribute to a world worth living in for us, our children, and generations to come. This book holds specific advice on issues that are on the mind of every business owner and leader at one point or another. I invited some of the brightest minds to contribute their perspectives on next-level entrepreneurship. We shed light on a range of interconnected topics that are critical success factors in today's business world. This is not a theoretical textbook. Instead, we offer actionable solutions that you can put into practice right away, written by business owners and leaders for business owners and leaders. Based on his Ten Commandments, Herman Simon helps us sharpen our understanding of pricing in a high-inflation environment. With the zeitgeist shifting our perception of businesses, Sheetal Kular introduces a model for a socially and environmentally sustainable business approach. Tony Martinetti and Terry Jackson offer insights into leadership components that allow us to build people-centric, high-performance cultures in the workplace. Teresa Quinlan and Ken Keyes show ways to overcome the outdated paradigm of work-life balance and instead self-actualize and achieve personal transformation. Depending on your personal experience, some chapters will be easier to engage with. Previously overlooked perspectives are waiting for you as you listen to some chapters with a beginner's mind. Other chapters hold suggestions that might feel unfamiliar or foreign at first sight. Allow yourself to approach them with the open mind of an eager learner to explore what's in it for you. I encourage you to embrace the full variety of topics we cover, as all of them are critical factors to living a happier, healthier, and more fulfilling life, including leading a limitless business. With that, I hope you enjoy the book and stay courageous. Theme 1. Three essential hard skills every business leader should master. The first theme addresses some essential hard skills for business leaders. I chose three topics that I consider highly relevant for anyone leading a company. In my over 20 years of working in business, I've collaborated with many types of entrepreneurs and corporate leaders. They range from early-stage startups to solopreneurs. Others are leaders of medium-sized enterprises, some of them family-owned, and others are corporate leaders of global enterprises. While these managers have varying needs in many ways, they do have more than a few things in common. They all operate in a marketplace with competitors. All of them want to sell their offerings to clients. They are all affected by consumer demands for a more sustainable way of doing business. No matter the size of a business, its industry, or governance structure, these three topics have major implications for any business leader. First, leaders need to understand strategy as a discipline to be able to paint a compelling vision for their business and create a strategy to bring their vision to life. Every business leader and entrepreneur needs to develop a level of strategic understanding sufficient enough to lead the way. Without a strategic plan in place, businesses lack clarity and direction. As a consequence, companies allocate resources to priorities that aren't mission-critical whatsoever. The resulting lack of focus leads businesses to stretch themselves too thin and miss out on what really matters for success. In my first chapter, I will focus on the topic of business strategy, using the examples of go-to-market strategies for startups and competitive strategies for corporations. The key to mastering business strategy is a consistent definition of strategy, a thorough understanding of the significant characteristics for an impactful strategy, and the place that ethics holds in strategy. The second implication is that business leaders need a better understanding of the biggest lever of profitability, pricing their services and products accurately. Especially during times of high inflation, pricing plays a crucial role in protecting your bottom line. Dr. Herman Simon, world-renowned management thinker and leading pricing authority, shares actionable insights on how to maximize the profit potential through pricing. He describes easy-to-implement approaches to discover the essential pricing drivers for your offering and how to turn them into measurable results. He also shares his 10 commandments for pricing in times of inflation, which come in handy. Simon describes the benefits of value pricing and why you should focus on economic profit as the ultimate measure of profitability. Once we understand how to implement tailored strategy and pricing to our business, we can move on to the third implication for leaders. We need to better understand how to realign our businesses sustainably. Companies embracing their responsibility to impact this world positively can strongly benefit from changing market demands fueled by more conscious consumption patterns. Reshaping a business's role by contributing to social and environmental justice is about combining planet, people, and profits into one cohesive approach. Sheetal Kular, a sustainable development and impact strategist, shares how we can overcome skepticism when talking about sustainability and profits. She shows us how businesses can fill knowledge gaps, create new value-based consumer touchpoints, and build effective partnerships. Chapter 1. Creating a Winning Business Strategy. It's easier said than done. Alex Brueckmann. If you ask three business owners what is strategy, you will likely receive three different definitions. Their answers might range from a plan on how we create value, or our priorities for the next few years, to an approach to winning against competitors, and a framework used to make decisions. There is nothing wrong with these answers. As a matter of fact, if you research a definition of the term strategy, you will find suggestions that match these ideas to a large degree. So, which definition is the most accurate? Which approach should be used for your business? I would accept any definition of strategy as long as it captures some of these ideas if used consistently in your business. This can prevent businesses from running into major issues with severe consequences. The term strategy is highly versatile in all aspects of life, from the world of sports to business and beyond. It does not come as a surprise that many find it difficult to make sense of it. This chapter will focus on strategy using examples of go-to-market strategies for startups and competitive strategies for corporations. I will define what strategy is, describe the characteristics and importance of an impactful strategy, and examine the ethics of strategy. What is a strategy anyway? The first matter to take care of is to define the term itself. For startups and entrepreneurs, the term strategy is closely associated with go-to-market strategy. How they plan to penetrate a specific market with a new product, technology, or service offering. Serial entrepreneur Richard Branson, the founder of Virgin Group, is quoted to have said, "And in the end, you just gotta say, screw it, just do it, and get on and try it." Now, Branson certainly made some significant business decisions in his life, and some questionable ones as well. Having learned from observing Branson, let me suggest that a screw-it, just-do-it attitude is the opposite of having a strategy at play. You might want to approach your business with a more focused approach. A simple way to develop a straightforward strategy is to start with the entrepreneurial strategy compass. It describes four types of strategies that help founders and entrepreneurs make educated rather than impulsive go-to-market decisions. How would these strategic go-to-market options look in operation for a real business? To understand further, I've come up with a not-so-hypothetical scenario. Let's assume you are an aspiring entrepreneur living in Bellevue, Washington, USA. It is 1994, and your name is Jeffrey, and you want to launch a business based on your best idea, selling books online. You examine the following strategic options to consider your ideal strategy to enter the market. Option number one, disruption. You pick one product category, books, and move fast. You compete against giant book retailers and take them by surprise. They don't take you seriously at first. However, your mission is to change that. Option number two, architectural. You create and control a new platform and allow retailers to sell their products via Amazon. Option number three, value chain. You partner with publishing houses, helping them circumvent retailers as gatekeepers, and use Amazon as a key to a profitable business-to-consumer B2C business. Option number four, intellectual property. You help large retailers modernize their size channels and build a white-label online bookstore. Strategic specificity matters more than you might think. It seems that Jeff Bezos maneuvered his strategic options wisely. Now, Amazon can hardly be described as a startup anymore, but rather a significant corporate player. In the corporate world, the term strategy describes an organization's business or competitive strategy. There are many examples of how the term lacks specificity and the potential issues that arise. Let me share two particularly notable examples, which are publicly accessible on the respective company websites of Porsche and Boeing. Example number one, Porsche, 2025 strategy. The company's main objective is to achieve value-generating growth. Only by achieving such growth can we make sustainable investments in innovative technologies, new products, and most importantly, in our team here at Porsche. With this approach, we are already on our way toward rethinking sporty mobility. We want to excite customers with our products and services. We also aim to consolidate our reputation as an excellent employer and business partner that fulfills its social and environmental responsibilities. And the return needs to be sufficient, too. Porsche's strategy consists of four key pillars. 1. Excellent employer and business partner. 2. Inspiring customers with a unique product and brand experience. 3. Excellent profitability with a return on sales of more than 15%. 4. Innovation and sustainable business practices. The pillars are specific, immediately showing an understanding of their intentions and direction. Porsche's four pillars are linked to each other. They also are mutually beneficial and could not stand on their own. No pillar is self-sustaining, and each point contributes to the main objective of value-generating growth. Also, the pillars align with their company. Anyone hearing them can quickly develop a clear understanding of any of them. This is a solid explanation of Porsche's main priorities and focus. It consists of concise sentences, is clearly structured, and contains a time frame with ways to measure their success. Let's be clear. This strategy description is better than many other examples of company business strategies. Example number two, Boeing, 2025 strategy. Enterprise strategy. Operate as one Boeing. Build strength on strength. Sharpen and accelerate to win. 2025 goals. Market leadership. Top quartile performance and returns. Growth fueled by productivity. Design manufacturing services excellence. Accelerated innovation. Global scale and depth. Best team, talent, and leaders. Top corporate citizen. Let's briefly examine the Boeing strategy. It does not consist of proper sentences and lists three brief bullet points followed by eight goals for 2025. This hardly qualifies as a strategy. It's a nondescript list rather than a description anyone can hear and comprehend. The three main bullet points couldn't be more generic and resemble internal corporate marketing jargon. The parts that could be measurable are unspecific. For example, it's unclear what they mean by top quartile, as it could refer to Fortune 500 companies, airplane producers, the aviation industry, or any number of things. The content and direction of the three strategic themes leave maximum room for interpretation, as they are nonspecific and very short. In addition, it is unclear how Boeing's themes and goals are related. Since the 1970s, Boeing's business strategies have resulted in a creeping loss of market share in its primary rival, Airbus. In the 2000s, Boeing failed to develop more fuel-efficient passenger planes. It became a major problem when their competitor Airbus introduced the A320neo, which became a bestseller. Boeing didn't have a comparable aircraft ready to compete. Due to the time and cost involved in designing a new plane from scratch, Boeing decided to update their existing 737 model with larger and more fuel-efficient engines and related design additions, sold as the 737 MAX, an upgrade. In October 2018, and again in March 2019, two 737 MAX aircraft crashed, with 346 casualties. The fallout for Boeing was significant. The 737 MAX models lost their clearance and were grounded. A United States Federal Aviation Agency investigation revealed that design flaws concealed by Boeing caused the disasters. As a result, the company lost the trust of regulators and the public. The total direct costs of the 737 MAX groundings are an estimated $20 billion U.S. dollars, and indirect costs are over $60 billion U.S. dollars. This excludes the $2.5 billion U.S. dollar settlement Boeing paid after being charged with fraud to avoid criminal prosecution. While I'm not suggesting that it was only because of their strategy, culture and leadership appear to have played a role as well. Boeing paid a high toll for their mistakes. I chose to examine Boeing's and Porsche's public plans to illustrate how vastly different strategies can look and how various companies communicate their strategies to the public. I'm sure internally, both companies adopt a more succinct and focused version of their strategies. However, this is what Boeing and Porsche are publicly declaring and sharing as their strategy. Other companies publish strategies that are looser vision statements, aspirations, or missions, which hardly qualify as strategies. Almost every organization I have worked with started by creating a new strategy based on an unclear understanding of the term strategy. But all of them, despite their fuzziness, still used the term in one way or another, despite their varying directions. For example, we need a new pricing strategy to compete with the other players in the market. Our hiring strategy is not delivering the talent pipeline we expect. We need a clear strategy for the purchasing discussion next week. Our digital product strategy is outdated. This omnipresent yet blurry understanding of the term strategy tends to cause even more issues up to the very top of organizations within senior leadership teams. Define the term strategy for your business. Ideally, a leadership team typically consists of accomplished professionals with years of experience. In these years, they would have seen different strategies, some more successfully implemented than others. They would have had exciting and sometimes long and tiring discussions about strategy. They would have potentially read classic books, such as Competitive Strategy by Michael E. Porter, who defined strategy as a competitive position, deliberately choosing a different set of activities to deliver a unique mix of value. And now these very individuals embark on a business venture to define a new strategy based on the variety of experiences and preconceived notions about what a strategy is and what it should contain in their views. As a result of this misalignment, Discussions about strategy are difficult and must be interpreted on a case-by-case basis, with their thoughts and individual understanding. Over time, my colleagues and I understood that before we could start strategizing with a client, we needed to help those involved form a common understanding of what strategy meant and how they would use the term going forward. What we often achieved was a common understanding and a definition along these lines. A strategy is a framework against which we make decisions to sustainably deliver our unique value to our customers, employees, and suppliers. It is a plan describing how we win in our chosen marketplace, where the unique value of our offering is repeatedly chosen over our competitors' offering. Based on this definition, let's describe what strategy is and what strategy is not. What strategy is? A set of key priorities to achieve a desired vision or goal, i.e., a desired state in the future. A plan that captures how you create value for employees, suppliers, and customers. A way to achieve results that will make your customers go, "Wow!" and leave your competition baffled, asking, "How did they do that?" A framework against which business decisions are made. A guide to the next 2 to 5 years. The big picture. A map helping you maneuver the business through partly uncharted territory. What strategy is not? A rigid and detailed plan that doesn't change. A magical formula that guarantees future business success. A formulated answer to questions of all disciplines in your company. A plan coping with every aspect of your business over the coming 10 years. Tactics. A bold statement about the future. Without a purposeful strategy, businesses can quickly derail. In the late aughts, I got to know an industry that was, and still is, heavily under pressure: high-volume printing. Back then, it involved mail-order catalogs, magazines, and direct mail. The company I worked for had a history of great financial success, and this success became their own worst enemy. For years, leadership and personnel alike had been clinging to the glorious past, where everyone had their share of the golden times. The issue was that these times were over, and the corporate culture had become complacent and change-averse. They were staying the course and hoping that better times would return. It seemed to be the strategy for many. With media advancements opening opportunities for e-commerce and publishers, market demand for catalogs and magazines had been shrinking rapidly. None of the leaders in the organization had experienced anything like this before in their careers. Until this point, change had occurred in small doses, within the subject expertise of those in charge. Change used to be incremental. In the aughts, the pace of change had shifted towards rapid transformational change in the printing industry. With one eye on the past and without a business strategy in place, leadership seemed paralyzed. Having reaped the fruits for decades without a real need for strategy, shareholders now demanded fast and bold moves to turn this printing company around and stop the financial bleeding. They opened the playing field for a newly appointed CEO and a company restructuring. Supported by a major management consultancy, the company now developed a strategy. They gave it their all, but unfortunately, it was too little, too late. The company had missed the right time to design a future-proof strategy. The inevitable happened. Shareholders lost their patience, the company was restructured, and thousands lost their jobs. This example is a devastating testimony of failure. Certainly not the leadership legacy anyone wants to leave behind. If you are socially conscious, you must act before it is too late. The good news is that there are many examples of great businesses that aren't complacent. And there are examples of great entrepreneurs and leaders, perhaps someone like you. If you care about the future of your family, you will figure out the best way to provide for them. If you care about the future of the environment, you will find ways to reduce your carbon footprint. And if you care about the future of the community you live in, you will dedicate your spare time to work towards a great place to live. Unfortunately, care is not always a driver in business. And I am not suggesting that every business strategy has a noble or altruistic nature. By looking around, you will quickly identify organizations with doubtful strategies. As a result, those organizations will lose a sense of their own identity. Over time, this process can hollow out the heart of an organization and profoundly damage the culture. An organization that suffered this fate was American bank Wells Fargo & Company. Since 2011, the bank had artificially inflated its sales growth by creating over 2 million fake bank accounts and credit card activations. In 2016, after this so-called sandbagging scandal had blown up, Wells Fargo paid a $185 million fine. The fine could be seen as pennies for a bank that size. The real fallout, apart from a loss of shareholder value, is more likely decreased trust by consumers, regulatory bodies, and investors. Not to mention the negative press worldwide and the public humiliation of former Wells Fargo CEO John Stumpf. In the aftermath, more than 5,000 employees were fired for misconduct, and in return, the bank sued its top management. In 2020, the U.S. government banned John Stumpf from ever working at a bank again and issued him a $17.5 million fine. This is just one example of what a derailed strategy without purpose can lead to. Unfortunately, there are more examples out there. Just think back to what caused the banking crisis in 2008 and how the shockwaves of this event affected the global economy and nations over more than a decade. Having no strategy in place is unethical. There are exceptional organizations that combine strategy and purpose into something impactful, providing meaning and direction to employees, suppliers, customers, and shareholders. To avoid falling into the marketing trap of fancy purpose statements without anchoring, purpose needs a strategy, and vice versa. One cannot exist without the other. The purpose is why an organization exists and needs to be more than just platitudes. Your purpose legitimizes your business, accrediting you in the eyes of others, and goes way beyond making money or securing jobs. To borrow an expression from Steve Jobs, the purpose is the ding you leave in the universe, which hopefully makes the world a better place. Without purpose, strategy can quickly derail and become mainly about profit maximization. Famous examples of derailed strategies of the recent past include car manufacturers, banks, and major sports organizations. And purpose without strategy? Well, at least it includes good intentions, and you might even live up to it to a certain degree. But that would be little more than sheer luck, and certainly not sustainable on a long-term scale. Strategy without purpose becomes mainly about profit maximization. Purpose without strategy is little more than just good intention. Having no strategy in place is irresponsible and unethical. As business owners, we carry responsibilities for our families, employees, and the communities we serve. If we run businesses unintentionally, without clarity about goals and desired impact, we are irresponsible, even unethical, because we fail to live up to our responsibilities. Without a clear strategy, businesses can lose everything at the snap of a finger: market value, the security of people's jobs, and the trust of business partners, clients, and the public. Creating and implementing a purposeful strategy is about taking charge and shaping the future. It is about conscious decisions with a clear focus. Without direction, you might as well jump on a random train leaving the station and hope for the best. This was how shareholders and leadership of the printing company I worked for seemed to have steered the organization for many years. Eventually, their destination was shutting down facilities, sending thousands of people and their families into unemployment and angst. Having no strategy in place is irresponsible and unethical. It's like gambling with borrowed money and the jobs of those working for you. In the end, the casino bank wins, and everyone else loses. For a moment, imagine if the leadership had put in place a proper strategy when the time was right, while the company was still enjoying the good times. Imagine they had backed up that strategy with a meaningful purpose that connected emotionally with the workforce. It seems likely that instead of just maximizing profits for as long as they could, the company could have established real value beyond money for their employees and the communities around them. Purpose is an essential element of organizational identity. It shapes the type of culture we envision and lays a foundation for steering an organization through times of change. If leaders truly embrace their responsibility, they create space for their organizations to design strategies beyond money, beyond simply managing to maintain the status quo. A great strategy is built on reinforcing loops. To describe the underlying behavioral patterns, Peter Senge, an American systems scientist, author, and senior lecturer at MIT Sloan School of Management, introduced the circles of causality, balancing loops and reinforcing loops. A balancing loop starts when we realize a change, a problem, or a threat to the status quo. As a result, we panic. We react in ways to get rid of the problem. Once we've achieved that, we relax and enjoy the regained balance until the next threat occurs. And the cycle starts anew, because we forget to redesign our action patterns and the way we operate systemically. Just like a company that realizes that their business is suffering, they react by creating some sort of strategy, probably containing a push for more sales and a cost-cutting program. Once the company sees the results of these measures, i.e., an improved financial situation, they will maintain the new equilibrium until the pressure returns. It is a reactive, fear-based, and crisis-oriented approach, resulting in strategies aiming to regain balance. And as they say, fear has never been a good advisor. The second circle Senge describes is a growth cycle, unleashing energy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.